Man, that's what you call a classic album, man. What's going on, man? Good? One thing that I love about my channel is that I get a ton of engagement. I get so many comments, so many questions. I try my best to answer all of them, but sometimes I don't get a chance to get to all of them. Some of them I don't even really see. So this is what we're going to do right now. I'm going to try to do these every month. The last one was in February, so now we're in March 2021. So without further ado, man, let's do what we do and then get to these questions. Intro. Yo, what up? My name is Vladimir Riche from ChaseAndBrider.com, and in today's video, I'm going to answer some of your questions. The first question comes from Mr. Ras Rooster, and he said, what is one thing you would buy for your wardrobe besides shoes and clothes to last a lifetime? One thing that I would buy to last a lifetime, not including clothes or shoes, would be accessories like pocket squares and ties. Those things are really supposed to last you a really long time, man. Maybe it's because I have a lot of them. But the oldest piece in my wardrobe is a Ralph Lauren purple label tie that I bought in 2009. Another thing that comes to mind also are watches. I don't know if watches are considered part of your wardrobe. I think that it should be. But watches are something that should last you a lifetime, man. So I've really been into watches lately. Not that I bought a whole lot of them, but I got a couple. So I don't really expect for those things to not last forever. You know what I mean? So I always look at my watches as things that I would be passing down to my kids. So I'd say watches and accessories like ties and pocket squares. The next question comes from my guy from the BX, Ivory Bailey. And he wanted to know, what should be the width of the bottom of your pants? And should it vary by the type of pants like jeans or dress slacks? That's a really good question, man. That's a question that I've gotten a lot. I've been meaning to make a video about it. I just never really got to it. So I will be making a video strictly having to do with trousers. But in the meantime, let me answer this question since I do get this question a lot. Personally, it's one thing that I didn't really pay attention to in the beginning until probably like within the past couple years. I used to just get my pants altered and I never really mentioned to my tailor how wide I wanted the bottom to be. I just let him do his own thing until my best friend was like, I think the bottom of your pants are too wide. And that's when I started to pay attention to them. So Ivory, I would say it depends, man, on a couple things. Number one is how wide do you like to wear your pants? Because the leg opening is going to correspond to the leg of the trousers. Like for example, you can't have the trouser legs be really wide around your calves and your thighs and then have the bottom be like really small. It's just not going to look right because it has to taper gradually from the top to the bottom. So it really depends on how you like to wear your trousers. And also one thing that I don't think a lot of guys consider is how big are your feet. If you have really big feet, you probably don't want to wear your trousers hem too small. It might make you look like a clown, literally like clown shoes, because it tapers too much and the shoes will look really, really big. So just something to consider, play around with it. Personally, my trousers are 8 inches at the bottom and my denim are 7 inches. That's what works for me, but definitely something you should play with to see what works for you. The next question comes from Claudio Rodriguez and he goes, what do you think of the whole quarantine situation and the people from all over the world are trending to use comfortable clothes? A lot of jogging, training, running sneakers.
Greetings from Argentina.
That's a good question, man. So I do think that with people working from home, the dress code is getting even more casual now. But that's something that started happening even prior to COVID. Like I see it walking around New York City the past 5 years, the dress code has definitely gone more casual, even on places like Wall Street. Like I remember Goldman Sachs a couple years ago changed their dress code to where their employees didn't even have to wear ties anymore. Now, how do I feel about it? It is what it is, you know what I mean? I just think that the less guys that wear suits, the more guys like us that do wear suits are going to stand out. Where I work, I don't have to wear a suit, but maybe once or twice a week, I still don't want a suit. Just to throw on a suit, man, because I like wearing a suit. But for the most part, I'm dressed the way that I'm dressed right now, which is a button-up shirt and a sport coat, you know what I mean? And even that is considered dressy nowadays, so. But it is what it is, man. I don't have an issue with it. The next question comes from Jeremy Miller, and he says, you mentioned that you still read about men's fashion. Could you share your top 3 sites or resources from where you read about men's fashion? Yeah, that's a good question, man. I've been asked that before also. Well, first of all, I don't really call it men's fashion. I call it menswear or classic menswear. Men's fashion is something totally different. Like, GQ magazine, that's men's fashion. What we talk about here is not that, but I know exactly what you mean, so let me just answer your question. Three sites that I still read to this day. The first one, I talk about it all the time, is Styleform. And it's a forum for men enthusiasts or guys that are trying to get into menswear where they can go and ask questions. And then, you know, guys with more experience can answer some of those questions. Also, people post their outfits daily depending on the thread, like what I'm wearing today thread, so you can see what certain guys are wearing and what the reaction to those outfits are. That's how I realized that the way that I used to dress was not good, because I would see all the props that some of the guys on there be getting, and I would look at the way that they used to dress compared to how I used to dress, and it was like a total 180. I used to be like, man, these guys' clothes are way too big, but how come he has 50 likes on these pictures? And that's when I started to realize, like, maybe the way that I'm dressed is not the right way, you know what I mean? It's a really cool site, man. So I think that every menswear enthusiast should check out Styleform. The second site I would recommend is Derrick Guy's site called Dye Workwear. That's a really, really cool blog also. So there's a lot of good articles on there. I've been reading that blog for years. And the third one that I still read to this day is Simon Compton's site called Permanent Style. If you're not familiar, Simon Compton is a dude from the UK, and he has a really, really nice site, man, where you can see a lot of articles, take some really nice pictures. And if I can throw a fourth one in there, it would be Put This On. If you go in the archive, they have so many really dope articles on there. So those would be the four that I would recommend. The next question comes from Joking Farfan, and he said, is it okay to keep shoe trees in your shoes for any length of time, or is there a time frame that you should take out the shoe trees, for example, after 1 week, or does it matter? Short answer is no. The shoe trees do not affect your shoes. So with my shoes, I have a pair of shoe trees for every single one of them. And if I'm not wearing the shoes, then the shoes have shoe trees in them. And depending on my rotation, sometimes I can go 3 months without wearing a pair of shoes, and I never notice anything wrong with them once I do decide to wear them and take the shoe trees out. So to answer your question, it's okay to leave the shoe trees in your shoes if you're not wearing the shoes. So I've never had any issues. The next question comes from Jay Smooth. He goes, how can you figure out what kind of last or shoe shape in general is best for your foot if you've never bought these type of shoes before and you can't try them out at the store? Now, there's a difference between a last that goes with your feet versus a last shape. Those are two different things. Like, for example, some lasts have a shallower instep. And if you're a guy that has a high instep, that last is probably not going to work for you. But one thing that I want to make clear, when it comes to shapes, so whether the last is round or square, it doesn't really have much to do with whether or not that last is gonna fit you. Like, certain shoes fit exactly the same, whether it's round or square. Like, some makers, their last would fit the same, it's just that the shape is different. So those things don't really correlate with each other. So that's just one thing that I wanna make clear. Now, it's all about a preference thing when it comes to last. It's not really something that has to do with fit. So that's just something that you don't have to try the shoes on to really tell whether or not you're going to like a round last or a square last. It's more like when you look at pictures of shoes, which one resonate with you the most. I think that's one way that you can decide whether or not you're going to go with a soft square, whether or not you're going to go with a round last without having to try the shoes on. Now, as far as buying shoes online without trying them on first, the key is to know exactly what kind of feet you have. Then you can explain to the shoemaker and he can tell you whether or not his lasts are going to fit you. That's not 100% foolproof. Like, I've told makers before, I have flat feet and sometimes they gape at the side and they'll tell me it'll be all right. Then I get the shoes and the gaping still happens. I made a whole video on that called How Your Shoes Should Fit. If you haven't seen it, I'll link it somewhere up here. I'll also include it in the description. And the second thing is to make sure that wherever you're buying those shoes from, they have a good return policy, so you don't have to worry about running into trouble when you're trying to mail the shoes back. Because chances are they're probably not going to fit. It's a 50-50 shot, right? So that would be my recommendation. The next question comes from Gerard Maccase. Actually, I'm not even sure if that's a question because there's no question mark, just 3 exclamation points. And he goes, how come your suit lapels are so wide? Because I like them? Next question. The next question comes from Miles Davis. And he goes, serious question. Are your shoulder lines supposed to look like that? I'm honestly asking because I noticed they seem a bit baggy, but it seems you do it on purpose. I always thought shoulder lines were supposed to be clean. Let me know. That's a good question, man. And I'm glad that Miles asked that question because I know that a lot of you are probably thinking it. but nobody ever said anything. I've been meaning to address it myself, but I just never really had a chance to. So I'm glad that Miles had the question so that we can talk about it. Now, well, to answer your question, yes, shoulder lines should be clean and straight. Now, the reason why mine look the way they look is because I'm sitting down. When I'm sitting down, the jacket, the back of the jacket cannot fall cleanly because I'm sitting down. Therefore, it bunches at the shoulders. For example, if you look at this video that I did where I was showing what I was wearing, as you can see when the video is side by side, the side where I'm standing up, you can see that the lines of the jackets are clean versus when I'm sitting down in the same jacket, you can see the bunching on the shoulders. So unfortunately, just one of those things that when you're sitting down, that's what happens. One way that I can fix that is by sitting on the jacket. So if I'm sitting on the jacket, like I'm pulling the jacket, so that'll alleviate the lines, but I always forget to do that and, you know, I don't really care. I always think that people will already know it's because I'm sitting down, but it is what it is. The next question comes from Ron Hallis. And he says, I'm thinking of buying my next pair of shoes and need some advice. Which one of these three makers do you think is the better of the three? Yeo Sal, Antonio Mercariello, and Act 10th. All right, that's a really good question. If you're familiar with this channel, you know that I have two of those three makers. I have Yeo Sal shoes, and I also have shoes from Act 10th. Unfortunately, I haven't gotten a chance to try Antonio Mercariello yet, but one of my friends has a few pairs, so I've definitely seen them in person. I've handled them. From what I can see, though, as far as from the naked eye without trying the shoes on, I would say that Yeo Sal and Act 10th or neck to neck. They're like 1A and 1B. Rumor has it they're made in the same factory, so, but we don't talk about rumors on this channel, so take that for what it's worth. But Yeo Sal and Act 10th are pretty close, man. Personally, I give Yeo Sal a slight edge, and that's simply because their last fit me so well. But as far as the finishes, the leather quality, I can't really tell a difference. Antonio Mercariello, on the other hand, at least from what I can see, I'd say Antonio Mercariello's shoes are slightly better than Yeo Sal and Act 10th. One thing that's kind of confusing though about Antonio Mercariello is that he has so many different construction methods. And also the shoes do take a long time to be completed. But from what I can see, I'd give Antonio Mercariello the edge over Act 10th and Yeo Sal. But of course, the shoes are also more expensive than Act 10th and Yeo Sal. So I would say it also depends on your budget. But those are three excellent brands. I'm a fan of all three. And then hopefully I can get my first pair of AM soon. The next question comes from Tony Perkins and he goes, what do you think about Magnati shoes? Yeah, we're not gonna do this today. This question came in before I actually did my Magnati video. So Tony, hopefully you saw that video. Anybody wondering what I'm talking about? If you haven't seen it, I'll link it somewhere up here. I'll also include it in the description. But in the last Q&A video that I did, I answered that question. So you can check it out there. Next question. Actually, that was the last question, man. Please keep them coming, because without you guys asking these questions, without you guys watching the videos, my channel wouldn't be where it is right now, so I truly appreciate it. So that was the Q&A for March 2021. Hit the thumbs up if you like this video. Subscribe, or everybody gonna think that you're a hater. And I'll catch you in the next video.